Welcome to the Faith Lutheran Church Sunday Morning Bible Study for March 26, 2017. Today, Pastor Jonathan Holmes leads us as we finish our discussion of Psalm 32. Let's listen in.
All right, let us go ahead and we'll begin with a word of prayer. Eternal God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, grant us your Holy Spirit who writes the preached word into our hearts so that we may receive and believe it and be glad and comforted by it in eternity. Glorify your word in our hearts. Make it so bright and warm that we find pleasure in it, and through your inspiration, think what is right. By your power, fulfill the word, for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. All righty then. Now, if Tom was right last week, and even though he's not here, we left off on verse 8 of Psalm 32.
Yep, because I've got stuff, little notes for verse 7.
Okay. So if somebody wants to read 11, excuse me, feel free to do so.
Well, I can.
Okay.
I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you and watch over you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, who have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the man who trusts in him. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad. You righteous, sing, all you who are upright in heart.
All right. So it seems kind of up to this point. We've been talking about those whose transgressions are forgiven, and kind of like the reaction that one who has been forgiven kind of does. Here now, we get to the instruction and the teaching and the way you should go. You know, kind of like this morning, talking about walking in the light.
Where are we?
We are on in Psalm 32, verse 8.
32,
38. Yep. And this is God talking. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. That instruction we cannot live without. Another word for instruction is doctrine, or the word. Our doctrine is Christ. And so he will instruct us in the ways. That's why catechesis in the church has been so important throughout the ages, because through that instruction we get the basics of our faith, and then after that's over we continue to strengthen it here. Because more often than not, those who have gone through the instruction but then stop rarely come back to church, it seems. I remember when I was in confirmation, I had 14 kids in my confirmation class. I went to parochial school, so it was rather large because of that. But there are some that never went to church after that, and I don't even know where they are anymore. I've not kept in contact with them because they've taken a very different road down their life for whatever reason. I'm not saying that they're living in debauchery and lawlessness by any means, but they don't go to church anymore. Why that is, anybody's guess at this point. I think part of it is that we've taught church wrong, what it's here for. At least when I was growing up, it seemed like church was just a good work you did. You went there and you gained some sort of brownie points of some sort, and you were good. And so you'd go every once in a while because, well, you just needed that quota, if you will, per year. Instead of making it what it really is, it is the evangelical tool, it is the gospel tool, it is the only place where you can hear forgiveness of your sins. Straight from the pastor's mouth, who is in the stead of by the command of Jesus to do so, to proclaim forgiveness, proclaim righteousness through the word. So, any questions on that? Thoughts, comments? if you've not gone through the catechism, for instance, I highly recommend it because it's the basic Lutheran confession of faith and the essentials of what we need to believe, to trust in order to gain eternal life. Martin Luther was quoted as saying, if you have not memorized the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, or the Ten Commandments, you're not worthy to even receive the body and blood of Christ. Now, I don't know the context of why he said that, but it does kind of give us a glimpse into needing to know the law and the gospel. To know that through the law, our sin is shown to us, that kind of instruction. But then we need to be instructed also with the gospel, the forgiveness of sins, in order that we can live a life boldly. Just kind of the basics, if you will. Excuse me. Yes, ma'am.
Not to take issue with Martin Luther, but to take issue with Martin Luther. To me, that's kind of an example, and I just use him as one, but an example of where man is putting an interpretation on something that I don't think God told him that, whereas in the Bible, where your things are said about that you must be baptized and you must believe and stuff. And I think maybe that is some of the reason that there are such divisions throughout the church.
Oh,
because
yeah.
There are so many different interpretations, and somebody puts a spin on it that, I mean, I don't think God said you have to know all of the commandments or you can't.
I think the reason Martin Luther says it is because Paul does talk about having to examine yourself.
Sure.
And I think that's where he was going with it, because there's a reason the Ten Commandments, the Creed, and the Lord's Prayer, that the order is very specific for a reason. The law starting at the gospel, the creed, and then Lord's Prayer he kind of uses as what the Christian life looks like. Just ends up what's happening. Eve.
No, just in speaking of that, it just comes to my mind that once you study that and you realize what the Bible is saying,
mm-hmm.
those things are just sort of common sense that you want to share.
Right.
Yeah, it just kind of comes together. It doesn't tell you God said so, but
mm-hmm.
your education, your intellect, and your knowledge of what you're grasping just kind of tells you that that's...
Right. And the good thing about the instruction, too, is you end up figuring out that you don't know, you can't understand it, which is why God talks about faith. Faith being that which receives God's gifts. Faith doesn't come by understanding, but it comes by the word and the sacraments. As he tells us, as Paul writes about that all over the place in his letters, especially. But the examination part is where we go with that. In fact, we don't have hymnals. It's in the small catechism, but they kind of have the Christian questions and answers. Historically, Lutherans have used that kind of as a self-examination tool to kind of prepare you for the supper. In fact, when I was at seminary, they had the old practice of having corporate confession and absolution the evening before we would celebrate the sacrament, and we would actually go through those Christian questions and their answers, just to help us examine ourselves, to help us realize that we are sinners, but help us realize too that there is forgiveness through Christ, and that's why the sacrament is there. Because if you don't understand yourself as a sinner, there's really no reason to even have the sacrament, because it's for the forgiveness of sins. Yeah, Frosty.
Well, I certainly couldn't take issue with Martin Luther for feeling that the Lord's Prayer and the Ten Commandments were pretty cut and thick and basic. And it may not be able to recite everything word for word, but you ought to at least understand what they are and what they mean.
Oh, yeah. Right. So, and that's why in the catechism he attached meanings to it to help with the instruction. because so many people have misinterpreted, like you've been talking about, what those actually mean. Because far too often, like I said this morning, like our text in Ephesians, people more often than not attach some sort of morality to that idea, rather than actually just letting it speak as it is. Because the walk of the child of light isn't to live the moral life, necessarily. It is to live in the life of your baptism, of forgiveness, to know that you will live in a moral life because you are a sinner, but that Christ has covered it up and that he has granted you free forgiveness, free righteousness through his death and his resurrection. To live in that. Then the moral life in some ways follows. Just because it's who we are now through the through our baptism, through the word, we are a new person. And one thing I didn't do very well in my sermon this morning was to get across that yes, you live in that darkness. You lived in a way that was contrary to what you confessed through your faith. But now, because you are baptized, because you have received forgiveness, you are just going to be a new person, a different person than you were before. Doesn't mean that we might, or that we won't fall into some sort of sin by any means. But when we sin now, we have somewhere to take it and put it, and that's on Jesus at the cross. It no longer runs our life. We see that it's covered. I didn't mention that in my sermon this morning, and I apologize because I was concentrating on not coughing up a lung. Thank you for the cough drop again. I got here wanting to grab some, and I found out I ate my last one apparently the other day. So, but yeah.
When you talk about being children of the light, it always reminds me of the story, and I never remember who wrote it, but it was one of the Greek philosophers about the cave dwellers and the man who goes out of the cave into the light and then goes back into the cave, and it's so much worse for him now because he knows what is out there. And I kind of think of that with our lives, that now that we have become children of the light, that when, for me anyway, when I do something that I know I shouldn't, or I realize I can't go back to certain things because mm-hmm. I know the difference. Mm-hmm. And it's just, it's wonderful in a way.
Yeah. It's scary and wonderful mm-hmm. all at the same time because mm-hmm. the sinner inside of you still wants to do it, but you know the saint in you is saying, you know, you left that behind. Let's run to Christ instead. Because, you know, we sin in thought, word, and deed, like we mentioned this morning. But Christ has covered it, and we can run to him. You know, that's why he says, all who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. That's who he is for us. And that's what we become. We can now rest. That's why Paul discusses the conscience so much. You know, a troubled conscience is not something God wants us to live with. He wants us to live free of the fear of death, the fear of hell. He wants us to live as his child and to know that it's him for us, for you. Anything else? Good discussion. Well, as if we had the glimpse of the gospel, we now get to do not be like a horse or a mule without understanding. I think we've kind of talked about this, though, talking about instruction. I'm not a big fan of the use of the word understanding, but there's no better way to put it in English, but it's just that understanding of through faith attached to it, because, like I said, faith doesn't come by understanding. But it's kind of like when Martin Luther, in the meaning to the first article of the Creed, where he talks about that he gives me my reason and all my senses. He's not talking about human reason, but the true reason, the real reason that we have, the real will that we now have in Christ, if I can use that kind of terminology. That which has been changed, that understanding which has been changed through the Word, through the spiriting of Christ, through his breathing, through the pastor. And so he tells us not to be mute, to just not go with the wind of change, as I think some people call it today. Because if anybody's ever watched or trained an animal of any kind, eventually they just follow it without any question. I noticed that with our dogs. Not that they're always the best, but you know, when I say go to your kennel, they go to their kennel. Because they know that when I get there to close the door, they're getting a treat. And so, you know, in some ways that is a gift-giving thing. But even if I were not to give them a treat the next time, because I'll forget, you know. That was me up there today, like just forgetting things, like trying to find my bulletin. I don't want to call myself an airhead necessarily, but I will forget to give the treat. But even next time, when I say go to the kennel, they'll go. I mean, it's just a part of what an animal is now. Now people try to say that we're like animals, but we keep getting instructed, but we keep following each time, don't we? Falling back into sin, even though we've been given the law and the gospel, we still fall back into it. An animal, not necessarily when they've been really instructed in something. Animals don't forget like humans do, it seems. So, but he's talking. But that, with that verse, he's talking about kind of the world philosophies and so-called theologies of. I always call it anthology, or what's the other word? Philanthropy of our day. Questions? Yeah, Frosty.
But as an old farm boy, I certainly can relate to the fact that most horses, some can be trained to do a lot of things on just vocal commands, but most horses would not know what to do. You know, they know giddy up and whoa. And gee and haw, but the
reins,
the reins and the bit and the bridle is really their control. Other than,
well, it's kind of like a bull too. The reason they had the piercing in their nose was that they would take a hook of some sort, and they'd have then the ability to pull them wherever they, you know. They would pull them because they don't want that to hurt, so they'll go wherever the person wants them to go.
Because, instead of charging the person.
Yeah, instead of bucking all, you know, killing the person, they have that hook, and it's kind of like, you know, when mom grabs your ear, you have no choice but to go along with mom because this hurts.
Yeah.
It's kind of that idea and why bulls have that ring.
But today that'd be called torture.
Yeah.
It would be. It's not humane enough to the animal.
Yeah.
I didn't know animals were humane to begin with either, so.
At a minimum.
So that's why women put, you know, 12 piercings in their cartilage.
Yeah.
Ow. I think it's also that you have to control them with the bit and the bridle because you can't really reason with them.
Right.
I mean, I try with my cats, but it doesn't
work. cats are different.
Yeah, that worked for you.
No, you're just staff to the cats.
Yeah.
We are.
You're just
we
hired
are.
Help.
They try to reason with us.
Yeah.
But, I mean, when you talk about them as being dumb animals, I mean, in a way, it's because the fact that you can talk all you want, but they're not going to answer you.
Right. Well, yeah.
But yeah, they have their own personalities.
Oh yeah, they have their own personalities. they do. They catch the words. They don't know the meaning, but they know that if they follow that word or come to that word, they know that something will happen. They'll be given something or whatnot. You know, I don't think the animals know that their name really is like our dog Chubbs. I don't think he knows that his name's Chubbs, but when he hears Chubbs, he knows he's either, one, done something wrong, or two, that he's going to receive something. Now, depends on what he's done and what he's going to receive. But many are the sorrows of the wicked. And that kind of, you know, brings me back to my sermon today, you know. You know, those who do not have unbelief are truly sorrowful. I'm not saying that all of them are like that, but in the end they will be sorrowful because they will be in eternal death. It's what God tells us. There's a placing of weeping and gnashing of teeth. I don't like to say that, but that's the truth, whether we like it or not. But that's why then this follows. But steadfast love surrounds the one who trusts in the Lord. The word that is translated as trusted, was it trust in there?
Unfailing.
Unfailing?
No, unfailing love. And then
unfailing love. I'm talking about trust in the Lord.
Oh, yeah, trust.
Trust
in
him. Mm-hmm. The word can also be translated as believe. That's the kind of trust we're talking about here. Something to believe in. Something, it's essential to do nothing but receive. You only trust those who do something for you. If I'm correctly assuming that, you know, the only reason I trust my wife is because she does something for me. Or, and she trusts me because I do something for her too. Because we have to earn trust in this life with people. God doesn't have to earn our trust necessarily. Well, he doesn't, because he's God. But we have something to believe in, something that we can receive something from, and that is God. Because all he's going to do is give us stuff. He doesn't ask for anything in return. You look marveled.
I'm just thinking that trust, to me, is a more active word than believe.
Okay.
Because it's almost like it requires more of a commitment mm-hmm. to trust somebody or something than to believe.
And that's why I like believe, because it is not our action, but Christ's action in us. Trust, like you said, there's a commitment. Like, I have to commit myself to this. We're incapable of doing that. Only Christ can commit us to himself.
And also, God never changes. So that trust or belief is something that you can do and not worry about, okay, is that going to change? Is something going to happen? Because you may trust your friends or whatever, and then one of them will turn around and do something that you wouldn't have expected or whatever, and so that trust is then shaken.
Mm-hmm.
But God isn't going to do that.
And I guess that's why I kind of like trust here better, because I can trust knowing that God doesn't change. It almost allows me a freedom to know that I can fully commit to that and not have to worry.
Right, but it's still belief, because that you're not committing yourself. Christ is committing you through his Holy Spirit. It's not our own actions. It's
God's doing all the work.
God's doing all the work. You know, it's like the third article, the meaning third article that Martin Luther writes. You know, I cannot by my own reason or strength believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him. But he has called me by the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, sanctified and kept me in the one true faith. It's all on Christ through the Holy Spirit, the giving of the Holy Spirit, that any of that is able to happen. Whether you like it or not, No, it's just, I was reading something this past week, and I love the line that he used. What did he say? In fact, I think it was while I was studying for the sermon this week. He says, you know, God's word is still God's word. It is always the truth, no matter what we think of it. There's a lot of people out there who are saying that, you know, God's word, you know, the Bible only contains God's word, that not all of it is divinely inspired, only certain portions, because they're picking which is truth and which isn't truth. But that doesn't mean it's no longer truth. They'll find that out on the last day, that truth was not to be nitpicked through or chosen here and there. All of it is truth through Christ. And because we have received the truth, we can now be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. After all this has taken place, in the end, we can still say, thanks be to God for the gifts I have received. We can be glad. We can be joyful. I'm leery to use the word happy because that's more of a misunderstood word in today's world. But that joy, that peace that we have through the Lord is something we can be glad in. It's something we can, I think you said sing for joy. Mm-hmm. I like that. Mm-hmm. Kind of like today at the end of our text, I don't think I mentioned it, but Paul says it is written, but nowhere in the scriptures is that actually anywhere. It's not an actual quote of the scriptures. The theory is that it's a quotation of a baptismal hymn in the early church. It's awake, O sleeper. What did it say? Yeah, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. This is something I really wish we had in our baptismal liturgy. Kind of after the waters have been poured over the head, say, awake, O, and actually the word can also be translated as dead one. Awake, O sleeper, awake, O one who was dead, and arise from that dead, for you now have life. You, Christ will shine on you from now on out, and through that light you receive life. It didn't hit me until we studied it this week on Tuesday. Now this.
We just need to send somebody an email.
Yeah, right? That's right.
What happens if you add something like that?
Oh, it's okay.
You're not doing anything contrary.
Yeah.
No. Doctor. Yeah, exactly. And that's what it really comes down to. But yeah, I can change it if I want. Darn it, I might. Because it's such a, especially in the Greek, it's so strong. Because the awake, the rising up from being dead. You know, it's, I hate to bring in this kind of image, but it's when the sun goes down with Dracula and he just rises out of his casket. Well, for us, it's the other way around. When the sun rises and we receive the light, we rise out of our casket, out of death, and go about our life in Christ. It's that kind of imagery. And it's not even us raising ourselves out of the casket, though. It's Christ coming and picking us up and carrying us away from it. That it's that strong kind of, which doesn't get along in a lot of the translations because of that. I mean, you can only use so many words in the Bible. I've started really realizing that some of these words, the reason that they're translated some of the way that they are is because of other traditions through history. And say, awake, O dead one, is probably the original intent of it. But over time, somebody came along, well, we're just rising from sleep. No, we're not asleep. Because somebody who's asleep still has blood going through their veins and is breathing. Now, this is talking about one who was dead, who was not breathing, who had no heartbeat, who had no brain function, and all of a sudden, now he has that stuff through Christ. That's what the waters of holy baptism do to us, what the word does to us through our life. So take that for what you will, but I rejoice in that imagery right there because it is so strong and detailed for us to understand what's going on. Because many people don't realize that baptism is a very violent thing taking place. The reason we don't dunk is because somebody commanded we had to dunk at baptism, and us Lutherans always, no, watch us. We're just going to pour water over their head. But that image that it used to be where you did take somebody under the water, I think provides that image a lot better than just water over the forehead. But that image that you are drowning the old Adam in you, but then he rises out, he's lifted up out of those waters and is now truly alive. It's that drowning scene in a movie. You just don't see it under the water.
It's interesting to me because the Lutheran faith, as I understand it, is one that likes to kind of go back to traditionally why we do certain things. And so if John was baptizing by immersion, you would think that the Lutheran Church would say it should be by immersion.
And the thing is, we won't say that one way is the way we have to do it, because there's not a command, nor is anything forbidding that way. Lutherans like to live in freedom, and so when you're free, you react against that which a law is trying to be placed, and you react against it, because.
I must be more Lutheran than I thought.
that's just it. It was the Anabaptists, I think, for the most part. We know them here in America as Mennonite and Amish, where they say that you must, immerge them in the water, and we react against that. No, where's that in here? There's no command saying to do that, and we're gonna take it a step farther. We're just gonna pour hell over their head. There's still water in the Word, and that's what makes it effective. Not if you drown them literally in the water, if you hold them down too long. I mean, that's what us Lutherans like to do. Like, give it to the man.
Of course, in the Middle Ages, it might have been construed as a bath, and you just didn't bathe.
Yeah, right? Yeah. But yes, be glad in the Lord. You are baptized. You are forgiven. You have that joy, you have that righteousness, not of your own doing, but Christ's, which is what the end of this psalm gets us to. I think we're going to stop there just because we only have 5 minutes left. So we'll get to 38 next week. But keep this psalm in mind when we get to 38, just because we'll need joy as we go through 38 a little bit. The more I study into the more I find a little bit of comfort in 38, because there was a point in some of my episodes of depression that I didn't know what to say. 38 are words that you can say. God is giving you the words to speak. And that's one of the nice things about the Psalms to begin with, is that, God is giving us the words to speak to Him. 38 is one of those types of psalms that we can speak back to our Lord when we are in sorrow, when we're angry with Him, or when we feel that we are not worthy of our Lord's love. He gives us these words to speak. Because then when we say this, there's always that other word that comes outside of ourselves and say, you are free, you are forgiven, you are righteous in Christ. And so by the time we're done with that psalm, I'm going to have to say that a lot, it seems. But any other questions about Psalm 32? Excuse me. Well, if not, God's blessings to your day and your week.
Thanks for listening to this Bible study presentation from Faith Lutheran Church in Moor Park, California. For more information, visit us on the web at faithmoorpark.com.